My name is Asia Stevens, and I'll be talking with the great Sir Lloyd. Known for his famous 80s sound system from Clapham, South London, it is an honour to speak with you. Please tell us about your younger years. Was it your passion to pursue a career as a DJ? Did your local town area help your career, or did you go to other towns to further your future?
With the music, I never had a problem with the area. Brixton was a very prominent black community where you get support from your local community, supporting what you're doing, providing that you're playing good music. And being around a popular sound system at the time, Soprano B, working in their record shop, was the hub for a lot of local artists and international artists. And at that time, Soprano B had a residency place called on a Sunday called Valley Eye, which was running every week from since 77 at that time. So everything just came in at the right time. So when I started my sound in 79, after being with my school friends from 76 when I started, and then we split up at the end of 78. So starting in 79, it was just the right timing, just the absolute right timing for what was going on at that particular time. And like I said, you know, I was working in Soprano B record shop, which was a very good, it was in the middle of Brixton Market, a good location. And like I said, it was a hub for all international and local artists and record labels to come to. And working in there, I get to meet a lot of people. So yeah, the area, no, I didn't have to go out. I just stayed in Brixton, which we nickname it the capital of London.
Yeah. What are your favourite genres of music?
Well, as Jamaican parents, we grew up in reggae. That reggae was influenced a lot by the American soul music, yeah. Blues music from in the 50s and 60s. So coming through soul music and reggae music in the late 60s, early 70s, and then you had another genre parallel to soca, calypso, because soca came along in 83 when Hot came out by Arrow, yeah. But yeah, in the 70s it was called calypso. You know, you had big tunes like Sugar Boom and Grenada made songs of that era. So yeah, my first love is reggae, coupled with soul and calypso.
Name a few of your favorite songs.
Oh, so many songs from the past to the present. More of the past, because quality and the standard of music was better in the 70s, 80s and 90s. Come the new millennium, there's it, for me, this is my personal opinion, it started to get fewer quality tunes than compared to how it was in the 90s and 80s and 70s. But yeah, songs, you know, there's so many songs like She's Royal, which is a good song by Taurus Riley. You got Mama Africa by Garnet Silk. Dennis Brown's got so many good songs like Here I Come, Wolf and Leopard, Money in My Pocket. Gregory Isaacs got loads of songs, Sugar Miner. I could go on. There's so many songs. Bob Marley. If you're talking about reggae, you know, and even DJ songs like Beanie Man. How much time have we got? There's so many good songs, man. So many.
We know your sister Candy MC'd on your sound system. Was it easy to work together?
Yeah, my younger sister Janet, sister Candy. Yeah, she came on the scene in the early 80s. And when we recorded that album, which was the launch pad for so many talent of that time, the likes of Tipper Irie, Philip Levy, Lorna G, just to name a few, it was a springboard for the UK artists in you know, when I recorded that January 1983, Sister Candy came on there, and she made a stand on that album, you know. She actually shone on that album. So working with my sister, it was good. And then we did later on, we did the following year in 84, we did the song called Keep Bubbling, which was a good song at the time, because every time I remember whenever the DJs will play Smiley Culture Police Officer, then my sister's song will come on the back of that.
Why did you particularly choose reggae music as your main platform?
Well, choosing it, I think it just came natural, because my parents from Jamaica, my dad was buying reggae music, yeah. You know, from reggae even to rock steady. Grew up in it. I actually grew up in reggae.
Being a DJ since 1976 and a record producer since 1982, when would you say that you felt your career was rising to success?
I think when I started the sound solo with Everett Wallace in 79, and then we got some members coming in that lived on the estate, and by 1980 I started to see the change in where what I did was to create my own audience. Just create my own audience. So I used to get a database where I would get people's names and addresses. In those days, it wasn't like you send texts. You had to send address. You had to get names and addresses and send the flyers and through the post. So you created your own fan base, your own mailing list. Guys like Gary Johnson, he took us out of the house parties, because what made us. What was the first part of the journey was when we was playing at private parties. Every time we play at a private party, it got overloaded in terms of it would always too many people. For example, if you was having a birthday party and you called me to play, I would come and play. But then what happened? You would have your people coming to your birthday party. But then because Sir Lloyd was playing there, people wanted to come.
Yeah.
You understand? So it was a kind of like a conflict of interest where you had outsiders coming in to your party. Do you understand?
Yeah.
So what Carrie Johnson did, he took us into what we call, in those days they called it blues dance, house party. They call it house party now, but in those days it was called blues.
Yeah.
So where anyone can come in, you pay your money, you come in. In those days it was £1 to go in. And believe me, £1 was a lot of money in those days. So we played out every Saturday from June 1980 to July 1982, every Saturday. And from that moment when we started to play in 1980, that's when I knew that, you know, the change came for us to branch out from private parties and go to blues dances. And from there, we just grew from strength to strength. And then by later that year, in 1980, we then started to build bigger boxes to play in halls.
Yeah.
You know, because then the demand came for us. People wanted to hear us in dance halls, you understand?
Did you see a change in behavior from people when you rose to prominence?
You get one and two. We got a lot of love from people. Supporting us when we grew, when we started playing at clubs like Providence every Friday. We had such a great following there. We played every year. We played that in that space of time. We played Bouncing Ball, Cubies, so many different places, and we got a lot of love. But at the same time, you get one or two haters.
Yeah.
One or two, for whatever reason. Yeah. A lot of support from people, you know, and then. When we went on to the following year in 1881, we went on to win the Reggae Awards in February 82. All the big, these are guys that are older than us. These are big men, you know. You're talking about Shaka, Frontline, Fat Man, Fox, and those sounds were getting called. And we were, as young boys, we were like teenagers, you know. The oldest one of all of us was 19. You understand? 19, 20, yeah. So we was all 16, 15, 16, 17, 18. And we came up against those big guys and we won the first Reggae BBC Radio London Reggae Awards. And that was at the Cafe Royal in Regent Street. Yeah, it was very... Tony Williams, Radio London, for Radio London Radio, really put the mark for reggae when he put on that actual event. Made it very prestigious. Comparison to the pop industry, where they had their one at Grosvenor Hotel. You know, so... he kept it in the Cafe Royal.
We know your songs played on mainstream radio, Funky Sensations by Lady Choice. Did you use your platform to inspire others to follow a career in your footsteps?
With the Live at Dick Shepherd School, like to excel, you know, like your Pete, Tipa Irie, Philip Levy, Lorna G, and then on the back of that, now I started to record Tipa Irie and Peter Huntingale.
Yeah.
You see, and they went on to do great things. You know, I was the platform for them to move forward. Same with Philip Levy, he went on to do one of the best songs of all time, "My God, My King," which was number one in Jamaica in 1984. You know, Maxi Priest was actually on that album. He wasn't on the album. I didn't put his material on the album, but he was at the session when he recorded it, representing Saxon. And that album, Live at DSYC, was the template for all these guys that you see now, like Stormzy,
yeah,
Tiny Templar, and all those American guys, you know, like Busta Rhyme and Twister, because it was out of that, it was that moment the fast talk started. So when you hear them man talk, well, they're talking very fast. But yeah, Peter King came up with a thing with a track called "Minute Me Sweet Me Know If You Do It." Me brush me here. You understand? Me brush me teeth. You understand? Good clothes, wear me wear, pants on shirt, they're not here. And from that fast talk, every genre has taken it up, whether it's jungle, funky house, what you got now? You got Afrobeat,
yeah.
You got drill. Do you know what I mean? All of them talk fast, and it's all because of Peter King from Saxon Sound System. When I released that album back in 1983, which got to number two in the charts. The only reason why it didn't go to number one in May 1983 was because Bob Marley's first album since he passed away in 1981, Buffalo Soldier, went straight in at number one.
Yeah.
And I said, you know what? I don't mind being second to Bob. That shows how good my album was. Yeah. You know, and it shows you how great the UK talent were, because then out of that, in come 1989, Peter Huntingale and Tipa Irie went on to record the best song of that year, 1989, which was called Ragamuffin Girl. And I just felt so proud to see those two guys top the charts for 6 weeks in June, July of that year.
Name some of the famous artists or musicians you put on vinyl first.
Paul Ektaja, I put her first single out. Tipa Irie, Peter Huntingale. Sandra Cross first solo, because when she broke away from Love and Unity in 1981, I recorded her the following year, 82, but didn't release it until 1984. And yet again, the template set for her when she had her biggest song ever, Country Living, the following year in 1985 with Mad Professor. There's quite a few people that I put out, put their songs on, their first songs on vinyl. Even a soul group called Ladies' Choice, which is my actual biggest song to date, got to the pop charts.
Yeah.
You know, number 40 in the pop charts in 1985, 86. People couldn't believe, say, look, because I'm coming from, I'm a, what you could call and say is a reggae sound. Do you understand? Even though we play soul and that, but we're coming from a reggae background. And look at that, I'm producing top quality soul tracks that was number four in the soul charts. Because the other three tracks that was ahead of it was Alice Be My Girl by Full Force, New York Eyes, which was number two, and number one was a monster great anthem song by Alexandra O'Neill and Sherelle, Saturday Love.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know that song. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Saturday.
I've heard that before, yeah.
I know, it's before your time, my dear.
How has reggae music evolved from when you started your career to now? And what impact did reggae music have on Britain's society?
Reggae music has evolved over the years when it came out in the late 60s. But I suppose it kind of opened the door and reggae really did bring people together. Yeah. In the late 60s, it actually got into the charts. A lot of it got into the charts with Desmond Dekker was Jamaica's biggest superstar at the time, and then followed by guys like Johnny Nash, and then Jimmy Cliff came along. So reggae really came out with a bang in the late 60s, early 70s. Reggae started to change in the sort of like around about say about 74, it started to get more roots, start be more conscious about, you know, about its identity of where being black. We had the likes of Bob and the Mighty Diamonds and Burning Spear. Those guys came up and started to do so you saw that change in the mid 70s. There was that root. So, you know, you had the girls like Janet Kane, 79, you know, the 80s where Shaggy, Shaka Demus and Pliers and embrace another audience.
Yeah.
You understand? Yeah. So reggae in every department, roots, dancehall and lovers, has brought a lot of people together and it's made it worldwide.
Do you prefer old school reggae music or modern reggae music?
I like both, but more old. But old school, what do you call old school? Is it, you know, because some people, like, old school.
Like, in comparison, like, for example, like, Sean Paul or, like, Bob Marley, kind of. Like, from that, like, ever, like, the 60s.
I like both. It depends on what kind of audience you're playing for.
Yeah.
Do you understand?
Yeah.
It depends on what kind of audience you're playing for. You know, you can have a session where, for example, a christening, weddings and birthdays, you tend to find that you play new and old. And then you can have a session where it's just strictly old school. You understand? Strictly 70s and 80s music, you know, depending on how deep you want to go. But I like playing both. You know, Sir Lloyd sound system was about playing new school and old school, and even fast and slow music. So there's times where you keep it going, banging, you know, you play a lot of active music.
Yeah.
That will get people moving. And then there's times you just take it down, you actually break it down and slow it down, and you start playing lovers, and then you bring the tempo up again. Playing out it's like a concert in a way. You don't want to hear songs that you don't know.
Yeah.
You may want to hear one or two, but you want to hear what you know. It's the same thing when you go to a dance, you want to hear what you know. In between that, you squeeze in some of the songs that you don't hear so much. And also it's also a platform for you to play new tunes.
We hear musicians struggling to promote their music during the pandemic. Has this affected you? And please explain any advantages or disadvantages to music promotion.
Well, the pandemic, so the online thing came more active. But mind you, there's not much record shops anyway. You know, so online was coming on anyway. But the lockdown made it even more active. So with social media now, what I find with social media, you can do it directly yourself now. You cut out the record companies. You don't need record companies. You can go and do it yourself. I mean, when you look at guys like, say, for example, I don't know if you remember Soulja Boy.
Yeah,
the Soulja Boy, he did it on his own. And look how much millions he sold. You know, he just put it on the platform on YouTube or Instagram wasn't out at that time. It was Facebook that just came out in 2000. I think that came out around about 2008 or 9, something like that. Media makes you take the music directly. So you've got like Ditto and CD Baby and so forth. You just take the music directly to the public yourself.
Would you say social media like Apple Music, Amazon Music, Spotify and YouTube play a major role in artists promoting themselves and creating a spotlight platform on their music?
Yeah, I mean, you just have to look at, say, for example, Alkaline. He's, for me personally, Alkaline is, you know, I don't rate him in a sense where when I say rate, I don't rate him. I mean, what I haven't, I can't name a song of his, yeah, that stands out to say, yeah, like Beanie Man, you can say, for example, Who Am I? And you can reel out the list of songs, for example.
Yeah.
But Alkaline hasn't got that kind of catalog, those kind of songs. He's got songs, he's got a catalog, but he hasn't got great songs like Beanie Man and Bounty Killer and Bojo Banton. You understand? But why I was so shocked when I saw, in a way, I was shocked when I saw he packed out Brixton Academy, and that's because of social media.
Yeah.
Social media allow you to go direct to the public, with Roots and Lovers and even Smiley Culture with Police Officer in 1984, which was the first MC song to go into the charts. And then from that, now you came into the 90s where guys like Shaggy and Shabba Ranks came along, you know, and then Sean Paul came along in the new millennium. So, you know, and then you got Chronics now is like the new Roots sensation. But there's so many others as well. There's too many to mention, you know, but just to give you an insight of reggae, you know, because the dancehall side of reggae really kicked force came alive in the 80s, but then started to chart. Sean Paul came along in the new millennium. So, you know, and then you got Chronics now is like the new Roots sensation. But there's so many others as well.
Has there been any shocking revelations during your years spent in the music industry?
Well, I think getting rid of vinyl was the shocking thing, me personally. But it had to come. It had to give because, you know, carrying coming too heavy and took up too much space. So that's why CD came along. And then CD was becoming a problem. So then you got MP3 now. God knows what they're going to come with next. But MP3, for me personally, I love it. You know, it's, you can download things whereby before you can, I used to go to, say, to cut a tune, yeah? I have to go all the way up to North London to Chris' studio or Barnes to John Hustle to go and cut one tune. And when you go there, the studio full of man already. You understand? So you're sitting down there for the whole day, coming like when you go barbershop. Yeah, sit on there, weird. Yeah, but now you don't have to. You can just email a song to a person now. You understand? Yeah, you can Bluetooth it, email it. So that's the beauty where the change I find. Another person I heard, you know, touch on the sense where back in the days, you know, you'd have artists will make it through the talent of their voice or their songwriting. Now it's a lot to do with packaging, how you look. You understand? Especially if you're black now, as a black artist, you tend to find that fair skinned chicks or fair skin. If you're fair skinned, it's a big plus.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, if you, I mean, look at India Irie, she's a, such a great singer and so forth, but, you know, she ain't going to get the same limelight as Beyonce, because Beyonce, she looked good. You understand? She looked good. Light skin, she shaped good, and she sounds good. And she's got a good character as well. You know? Yeah, so it, yeah, it's an image thing. So, you know, you got Nicki Minaj is the same thing. You know? If Nicki Minaj was dark, I often say to myself, if Beyonce was dark, like say Spice, would she get that full attention?
No.
You know, it's the same with Michael Jackson, hence why he had to go down that road. You know, and it's a shame when you have to do those things. Why can't people accept you for where you are?
Totally.
You know what I mean? But I suppose that's the way it is, I suppose. But we have to change that. Although it has changed, because there is people are making it being dark skinned. Do you understand?
Yeah. Change will happen, but then
I think the change has happened already, you know. But you would always get, but you know, you would always get that with the major companies would always try and push the narrative of light skinned people.
Yeah.
I do know why, but I do know why.
Please tell us your greatest achievements or highlights throughout your career.
Well, there's quite a few of them. I think one of them was when I picked up the Reggae Awards in 1982, February, for the best sound system. That was one, you know. And there's so many highlights. It's you know, it's too many to mention. Being abroad in Dublin was one, and when I played with Sir George as a sound system, that was a big session. That was a real good session. There's so many sessions that you know, that was really highlight of my career. There's so many of them. It's too many to remember. To mention, I mean, you know.
Looking into the future, what do you see yourself doing next?
Well, I like to write a book and then turn that into a motion movie. That would be one. And also completing Sir Lloyd album number 4 and to go on tour with it.
Oh, that'd be good, yeah.
That and the tour, that and the book will be really good. So it's finding the time to write the book, which is
thank you for an amazing interview, Sir Lloyd, everybody. Please tell us where we can find your music.
Well, you can find my music on Amazon, YouTube, and also dubbendermusic.co.uk, and also on you can email me directly on lloydslam21@yahoo.co.uk.